Hey, what's up guys? So I'm really excited about today's video because I finally got a chance to review the new Apple MacBook with the M1 chip. And I have a lot to say, so stay tuned. You guys might have heard all the hype after the M1 chip, and I have to say it stands true. It is worth it. But let's start off by talking about the design. So design-wise, Apple has not made that much of a leap. It looks the same as the previous models. So I upgraded from the Apple MacBook Pro 2017, and from a design perspective, I do not see anything that's different. However, I am a little disappointed because my 2017 MacBook Pro had 4 USB-C ports, and this one has only 2. So going up in 2020, you reduce the amount of USB-C ports available because there's a possibility that you might add more ports to your higher end 16-inch model, which is really, really disappointing. I would have preferred the 4 USB-C ports, but there's always a workaround. I can add external USB and extend the ports, but it is a hassle, and that is not expected from Apple, so I'm disappointed about that. But realistically speaking, Apple's MacBook Pro is still very sleek looking. Even against the competitors, I think it's one of the most sleek looking Apple computers. I just love the aluminum feel. I just love how it shines, and it's very durable and solidly built. Now, this model I have right here in front of me is the 13-inch MacBook Pro. The screen size is 13.13 inches, and it has the M1 chip, 512 gigabytes of SSD, and 16 gigabytes of memory. Now, a lot of you might have had a hard time choosing between the MacBook Air and the MacBook Pro. So I will go over why I chose the MacBook Pro over the MacBook Air, and maybe it will help you out deciding between the new MacBook Air and the MacBook Pro. Now, the MacBook Pro is 100 nits brighter than the MacBook Air. For me, that's not a big difference, but for those of you that like more brightness in your laptops, this one is 100 nits more brighter. Apple has not gotten rid of their ugly touch bar. I feel like this is like the most useless feature that Apple has implemented on the MacBook Pro, and I have till date to use it for shortcuts, or I don't even see it that much integrated within the apps. I don't know why Apple would not get rid of it and maybe help to add more to the battery life by getting rid of it. I mean, it's such a hated feature by a lot of users that I would actually pay Apple to get rid of it. But unfortunately, we're stuck with the touch bar on the MacBook Pro. For you MacBook Air users, you guys were lucky. You guys don't have the touch bar. So internally, the MacBook Pro comes with a fan, while the MacBook Air is passively cooled. And that was like one of the main reasons why I upgraded to the MacBook Pro. For example, if you do 3D encoding or video rendering, there's a chance that your MacBook might heat up and the fan will help it cool down and you can get more processing power out of that. The MacBook Air, on the other hand, is passively cooled, so there is a chance when it heats up, the performance might slow down. Now, the MacBook Air is missing one GPU, while the MacBook Pro is not missing a GPU. I don't think one GPU is going to make that much of a difference, but for those of you that are concerned about that, yeah, the MacBook Pro does have one more GPU. So the MacBook Pro M1 chip comes with 8 GPU cores and 8 CPU cores. You're able to run your iPad and iPhone apps on the MacBook Pro, which I think is really useful because sometimes I purchase apps on my iPhone and I'm not able to use them on my MacBook Pro. So now if I purchase them on my iPhone, I should be able to use them on the MacBook Pro, which is a welcome feature. Now, however, there are compatibility issues. So some of the apps are not running natively on the M1 chip, so they're using the Rosetta emulator, which is a great emulator. So Rosetta 2 makes it very seamless. For some of the apps, the first time you load the app, it might take 10 seconds to load up. But other than that, I can't really even tell that they're using the Rosetta emulator because it's so good. A lot of users were disappointed that Adobe Photoshop is not running natively on the M1 chip. So if you use Adobe Photoshop, you might want to hold off on upgrading to the M1 chip. You might want to hold off on upgrading to the M1 chip MacBook Pro. Now, I have been using the MacBook Pro for over a month now, and I am really impressed. The apps are loading really faster. Safari is even working faster. And when I open the screen, the instant on feature is really helpful as well. However, there was one instance when I went on a website, and this website had these pop-up windows. So a pop-up window to subscribe, enter your email, and then another pop-up window telling me about the sales that are running. So when all of these pop-ups and scripts ran together, the MacBook crashed and I had to restart it. I went back to the same site to test it again. The same crash happened the second time. Now this crash happened three times, and this happened the first day I received the MacBook Pro and I tried it. I tried it again before this review. It is not happening. I guess Apple is working on the bugs, but that's something you should be aware of, that there is still some compatibility issues. There are some issues that Apple needs to fix. They're minor in my case. You might encounter major bugs, but for me, there were minor bugs. And besides just like the apps loading faster and everything being better, even the SSD is faster. And this is probably due to the M1 chip. So go ahead and do that speed test on your SSD and you'll know what I'm talking about, because there is a noticeable difference. Coming to the main reason why I upgraded to this MacBook Pro, I had a fully spec'd out 2017 MacBook Pro. It had an i7 processor, 512 gigabytes of SSD, 16 GB RAM, and it did a fine job. I had no crashes, no bugs, nothing of that sort. It ran very smoothly. The fans would occasionally turn on when it would heat up. I have yet to hear the fans turn on in the MacBook Pro. So the main reason why I upgraded to the M1 chip is because of my video encoding and Final Cut Pro. So when I use Final Cut Pro in my 2017 MacBook Pro, and I'm rendering a 10-minute video with 4K with a LUT on it, it would take sometimes between 30 to 50 minutes just to render a 10-minute clip, which is really unacceptable. Now, running the same rendering on the MacBook Pro M1, I tried it, and I was shocked because it took only 10 minutes, 16 minutes max, to render the same file. On top of that, it used about 3 to 5% battery life to do it, and the fans didn't even turn on. That's how efficient the M1 chip is. And for me, that just alone was a major reason to use this, because rendering in the MacBook Pro was a hassle. I'm excited to see what Apple will do with the iMacs, and I'm pretty sure it will blow the MacBook out of the water. This video will not be complete if I don't talk about the battery life. The battery life on the MacBook Pro is amazing. So I ran a video on YouTube and I let it run over and over again. It took 16 hours to completely drain out the battery. 16 hours, that is insane. And you really, really have to work hard to completely drain your battery in the entire day. So you would have to do a lot of browsing, do a lot of YouTube video watching, do a lot of Final Cut Pro editing to completely drain the battery. And you would really, really, really have to work on it. So I can say with moderate use, you should be able to get 2 days of use out of the MacBook Pro, which I think should have been the norm like 3 years ago. But with Intel's chip, Apple was struggling to do that. So I'm really, really happy that Apple made the move to the M1 chip, because for us consumers, this is the best that could have happened. I'm excited to see what other improvements Apple will come up with in the next iteration of the M1 chip. That being said, however, there are some negatives that come with the MacBook Pro M1, and I did want to discuss them with you guys. Currently, the max you can expand the memory to is 16 gigabytes. For for whatever I do, I think 16 gigabytes is enough. And this is probably due to the limitation of the M1 chip, so they can only max out at 16 gigabytes. Maybe they'll expand it in the future, but that's something you should be aware of. With the Intel chip, you can go beyond 16 gigabytes. However, I personally don't think I need more than 16 gigabytes for everything I'm doing. The M1 chip is more than efficient. So you cannot connect the MacBook Pro to multiple external displays unless you use some type of an adapter. So that's something you should be aware of for those of you that use your MacBook for work. So that's a limitation. There's another limitation. There is no external GPU support. An Intel-based MacBook would be your best bet at the moment because there is no external GPU support. However, the graphics on the MacBook Pro is insane. You are able to play most games. However, that being said, the graphics on the MacBook Pro M1 are amazing. They get the job done for most tasks. Now, getting to the second biggest disappointment I had, first being only two USB-C ports. The second biggest disappointment I have is the built-in webcam. It is astonishing that Apple is still using a 720p webcam. Now, they do say they have made updates to it, so it's more clear. However, in my testing, I was not able to see much of a difference between my 2017 MacBook Pro and the 2020 M1 chip webcam. I still feel like it's a disappointment. They should definitely move it up to 1080p, and they should definitely do something about the lighting issue. So you need some external lighting source when you're using the webcam built into the MacBook. Maybe Apple should work on something where they have an internal lighting source so you're more clear on the webcam. So that is one of the biggest disappointments, especially since we're in 2021. In 2021, a webcam should not be something that I should be talking about. Now, Apple does claim the MacBook Pro has studio quality mic from the webcam. I can say yes, I had no complaints in the 2017 MacBook Pro as well. But however, I'm still very disappointed at the webcam. And at this point, we should be at 1080p. Especially because a lot of us use the FaceTime feature in the MacBook Pros to communicate to our family, friends, and even coworkers. So Apple, please improve on that. It's a big disappointment. So overall, the M1 MacBook Pro is a great choice. If you are doing some video editing using Final Cut Pro, for example, and you will be using apps that use a lot of resources, I would highly recommend getting the MacBook Pro because of the built-in fan. So you can go longer without reducing the performance. However, if you're a base user, so when I say a base user, I mean using the MacBook for browsing the web, watching some YouTube videos, maybe typing in pages, then you can go ahead and save a lot of money and stick with the MacBook Air. If you, however, don't care about the portability and don't need a laptop, then I would highly suggest waiting for the iMac because the GPUs and the CPUs on the iMacs is going to be insane and you will get a lot of performance. So I highly recommend waiting for them if you don't care about portability in your computer. So that's it for today's video, guys. I hope you liked it. I'll leave the affiliate link in the description box below. Leave your comments below. I mean, if you guys are using it, what do you think? Is there any suggestions that you think Apple should take in improving the MacBooks? Let me know. I want to hear your thoughts. So don't forget to subscribe. Hit that like button if this video has helped you out. And until next time, see you guys.